The second, of course, is Omar Khadr. I mean, he was a child soldier, which I just found out that one of our government officials, when was asked about it, said, oh, child soldier? I thought child soldiers were only Africans. So that's the extent of our information. And he is sitting, and we have been asking for him to be brought back. And if he, you know, tried in the Canadian courts, if he has to be. These are the cases which directly impact our civil liberties right here in Canada. And I think we have not heard much about it, and I agree with my friend that the Winnipeg community, which is known for its passion for civil liberties and human rights and so forth, has not been as vocal and as organized as we need to be, because we get sidetracked by many other things. But these are the issues right now at home. The five under the secret evidence, there are five Canadians that are being held right now without charges for indefinite time. This is the process of law. And once you can take away the due process of law, or you can compromise it for any state in any country, that is the beginning of the end. Because today it may be the Muslims and the Arabs, tomorrow it could be anyone else. So I think pay attention to what is happening right under our noses, because it is impacting our future. And if we don't pay attention. Now, honestly, I think right after 2001, I was in this forum talking about what we fear could happen, and people, oh, no, not in Canada. It has happened. Okay? And it is being done with people. Politicians are standing up and saying, so what? I mean, that is the extent of normalizing the compromise of due process of law and human rights and civil liberties. Mm-hmm. So I think it's important that we pay attention right here at home.
Thank you very much. Yep.
Hi. Kind of worried that none of you will take on my question, but anyway. My name is Pejanakut. I am the Ogima Khan of the Free Ojibwe, the few and the proud, the modern faith keepers of the Anishinaabe Nation. In 2003, I considered myself a patriot of Canada. I desperately wanted to contribute, to make positive contributions to Canada. But in 2005, I became a separatist because of all the harassment from the common Canadian and discrimination from Canadian businesses and organizations. So I define a patriot as a person who abides by their constitution and will defend their constitution. So being that multiculturalism is part of the Canadian constitution, I believe that the common Canadian who engages in harassment or utter discriminatory action is in fact an enemy of the state, weakening the country. In my case, they drove me to want to become a separatist. So my question to any of you is, do you agree or disagree that the common racist person in Canada should be considered an enemy of the state? And if you do agree or disagree, why? No one wants to take it on, eh?
Could you repeat that, please?
What, the whole thing?
Just that, the question part.
Just do you agree or disagree that you can consider the common racist in Canada an enemy of the state because of the fact that they are not abiding by the Constitution, that they are weakening our multicultural society by driving wedges between the people?
Well, the problem with that premise is that the state adheres to the law. And there's no evidence that the state is anywhere near adhering to the law, enforcing the law. The law is for street people in places like Winnipeg. The law is for poor people. I mean, everything proves that the law is to defend the property of the rich from the incursions of the poor. And even if we have statements like, say after the Civil War, the statements to free the slave, you know, that everybody has the right of life, liberty, and possession of property, I think it was. And then that was used to say that corporations are persons and they have equal rights. So even when we get these bold statements of high-sounding idealism, the people who invoke, who have the money to purchase the legal talents to make the case. So it just becomes totally demoralizing living in a state where the state, does the state recognize and affirm Aboriginal and treaty rights? I mean, I've been in court talking about this for 22 days. Like, there's in our constitution the existing Aboriginal and treaty rights of the Aboriginal peoples of Canada are hereby recognized and affirmed, Section 35 of Constitution Act 1982. Who is doing this affirming and recognizing of Aboriginal peoples? When you go to court, there is the Crown, the representative of Her Majesty, always denying and negating. So the average Canadian, I'd say, these are our people, these are our citizens. And if there is racism among us, we've all have to deal with this. None of us have really can say, you know, we are without our issues of group thinking, and we see patterns in life. So I would say, no, it's the state that has a problem with adhering to the law, and it's our fellow citizens that we have to reach out to, including in the police. And, you know, appeal to people in the police. You're just a political force. You don't uphold the law. We said that on the train tracks at Long Lake 58 in 1990. You're supposed to be upholding Aboriginal and treaty rights. Who's ever gone to court for violating an Aboriginal and treaty right? Who's ever gone to jail for violating an Aboriginal treaty right? In the streets of Winnipeg, a dark-skinned person makes one little infraction. The police are on, so phone Crime Stoppers and say, I want to report a violation of a treaty right. What a disgrace that we have these treaties that are the basis of our sovereignty, our land, our relationship to the land. And the government says, you got your $5, now move along. You got your $5 for your treaty right. And we won't talk about the treaties, we'll talk about the Indian Act, which is totally in violation of Section 35. The Indian Act has nothing to do with recognizing and affirming Aboriginal treaty rights. The Indian Act is obviously unconstitutional. So it's the state that's the problem, and it's the people that are the answer. And rather than condemning your average Canadian as racist, which might be perfectly justifiable, we've got to try to love one another, try to get together and talk through our differences and deal with a lawless state that spits on our constitution. Thank you.
I just want to make one last little point. I want to call somebody the enemy of the state, so I'm going to call the government the enemy of the state.
I just want to add something there. You called yourself a separatist, but you're not really a separatist. You're a sovereigntist. You're a tribal sovereigntist. You're part of something that predates Canada, and that is why the treaties were signed in the first place. Miigwech.
I'm Steve Schaefer. I want to ask a question of all of you, a question concerning the internet, and I want to make a couple of comments leading up to it. First of all, I came to Canada in 1974. I became a Canadian citizen actually only recently. There's a lot of flaws in what's happening in Canada and our government, but I think we are a democracy that is phenomenal compared with many, many other places in the world. And we have serious problems, and I agree with those of you who have said that we, as individuals, as well as groups, need to do something about it. And my question relates to that. I'm concerned, for instance, Leslie Hughes, you mentioned Democracy Now. I've gone to Democracy Now, and I have to say that I'm very concerned about Democracy Now expressing very one-sided opinions. And my concern goes way beyond Democracy Now. Many, many websites on the internet express one side. That's their right, I guess, but they do express opinions rather than facts. They present sometimes facts, but they're one-sided, so they leave out an awful lot, and it leaves those of us who are reading from their websites real questions as to, you know, is it accurate, is it completely the facts? I think in regard to your comment about Black Rod, yeah, Black Rod doesn't identify who they are, but on the other hand, the hundreds of thousands of